Requesting everyone else to mute their mics and videos.
Patient Mr. Kamal Chauhan, a 60-year-old Hindu married male residing at Turbhe, Sector 7, laborer by occupation, underwent an elective temporary loop colostomy in left iliac fossa following an anterior resection for rectal cancer 10 days back. Patient is well and the stoma has started functioning with passage of semi-solid effluent once a day. History of complication, no history of irritation or pain at the site of stoma, no history of bleeding from the edge, no history of discharge associated with fever, no evidence of slugging or any change in color at stomal site, no history of diarrhea or impaction of stools, no history of increased or decreased output associated with pain or distension of abdomen, no history of bleeding for rectum or tenesmus, no history of increase or decrease of size of stoma on standing and supine position. History of care? Yes, sir.
Again, go back to last slide.
Yes.
Yeah. Now, please explain each one what all things you have ruled out by asking this negative history. One by one.
Sir, history of irritation or pain? It tells about the inflammation, if there is any inflammation at the site of stoma. Discharge is associated with any kind of infection, bacterial infection.
Bleeding?
Bleeding, so one moment. Can I sir refer?
You can tell actually. No need to have a look at a book actually, because it's like a mock exam. So try to recollect and tell. It's okay.
Right. So bleeding can be associated with any infection or inflammation which has happened.
Bleeding why?
Sorry, sir?
I can't hear you. There's an audio break.
Bleeding can happen when there is any kind of infection or inflammation.
Sorry, Shatabdi, but I can't hear you anything. Just a few sounds.
Hello. Hello, sir. Hello.
Shatabdi, we can hear you.
You can hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. No.
Discharge will be due to any kind of infection.
Okay.
Change in color can happen due to necrosis.
Uh-huh.
Then increase or decrease in output. Decrease in output can happen when there is a decrease in output can happen when there is dehydration or electrolyte disturbances.
Okay.
Increase in output can happen when there is more of liquid content. Something maybe due to diarrhea.
Okay.
Bleeding for rectum and tenesmus, that is pain. That can happen because he was a patient of carcinoma rectum.
Shatabdi, what I'm asking that how tenesmus is the complication of colostomy. Bleeding, I can understand. There can be some internal hemorrhage that can have from the stoma site, and patient may pass blood. That is okay. How tenesmus?
That is pain.
I know. What I'm asking. Mm-hmm. Is it a complication of colostomy?
It is
a complication of rectum. That is fine.
Right.
or right. rather not a, not even complication, it is actually a presenting symptom of CA right. colon or CA rectum.
Right.
But that is certainly not a complication of colostomy as such.
Okay.
Presenting okay. a colostomy. So okay. you may mention that just a bleeding. PR.
Okay.
I don't think you should mention this. Hmm?
Okay.
Okay, next.
Increase or decrease in size of stoma, that can happen when there is stenosis or stricture in the stromal side. That is when there is decrease in the size of stoma.
See, increase and decrease in size of stoma is something different.
Okay.
What you are talking, that is the stenosis or stricture, will lead to decrease in the output of the stoma. There are two right. different complete. Right? So please do not intermix it. If you want okay. to mention in context with output, then there is a luminal narrowing or some internal stricture formation or some stenosis or some blockage, say fecal impaction, etc. That all points you may mention if you are concerned with the change in the output from the stomal side.
Okay.
However, if you are mentioning increase or decrease of size of stoma, so that's... increase and decrease in size of stoma can happen only in two conditions. First, increase will happen when there is a prolapse of the stoma, and the decrease will happen when there is a retraction of the stoma. So only these two things will actually either increase or decrease the size of a swelling, that stoma per se. So when you're mentioning about this, don't mix it with the output. Output is different. Okay. On the diarrhea, and you mentioned impaction of stools, that is because of the change in the diet. It is not per se because of the colostomy. Okay. So that you need to mention when the examiner asks you why you are asking this. You can mention that maybe patient has not yet tolerated properly or adjusted to the modified diet pattern, what has been advocated to that particular individual patient. That is why diarrhea is happening, or maybe constipation and subsequent fecal impaction is happening. Okay. So you mention whatever is practical, logical, and obvious when you're mentioning about these complications. What you mentioned is correct. That is not a problem. But when you're explaining, or when the examiner asks you to explain each one of why you are asking this, etc., at that time your explanation has to be proper.
Okay.
So you please mention accordingly. Now proceed. Next slide. Yes.
History of care. Patient was well counseled for stomal care preoperatively. Patient is able to manage the stomal bag. The bag is changed once in 3 days. Proper care of parastomal area is taken. Patient is advised with high fiber diet and plenty of fluids. Self finger dilation is done by patient at regular intervals.
Okay.
Past history. Patient was a known case of carcinoma rectum and was operated for the same. Personal history. No significant personal history. And no significant family history. Okay. General examination. Patient is conscious, cooperative, well-oriented in time, place, and person. Averagely built and nourished. Decubitus supine. Vitals. 98.6 degree Fahrenheit or febrile. As taken by thermometer on right axilla. Pulse 78 beats per minute in right radial artery. Regular rhythm, adequate volume, normal force, tension, and character. With no radio-radial or radio-femoral delay. No apex pulse deficit. Respiratory rate 13 cycles per minute with regular rhythm.
Okay, Shatam. Abdominal. What is self-finger dilatation? There is a query from one of the participants. Can you explain to them? In the previous slide, you mentioned one line that patient has been taught or patient is doing self-finger dilatation.
Yes, sir.
Can you please explain?
Yes, sir. Self-finger dilatation. So self-finger dilatation is taught to the patient so that there is no accumulation of stools or closure of the stoma due to the accumulation of stools. So there is
can you please explain how exactly patient does it?
Sir, I do not know how exactly this.
And which finger? I mean, thumb, index, ring, middle. What? Which finger? And what is it? See, the whole rationale of doing this self finger dilatation is what happens when you make a stoma, and when the stoma matures, initial part there can be temporary blockage to the mouth or the opening of the stoma, and it may remain for some time. The aperture will close, or the mouth will close, and eventually when the flatus and feces is coming out, it may open. Or it may not open. That is a possibility. But if it remains closed for a long time, then it is not very a good thing for the patient, because patient will have a lot of discomfort. So what is important is you educate the patient to do a self-dilatation. It is a type of a self-dilatation. As you are aware, patient who are or chronic catheterized patients, or patient who are going into frequent retention of urine, are taught how to do self clean intermittent dilatation, if you remember, in urology. So the same principle is applicable here. Here only it is a self clean intermittent dilatation of the stoma at what patient is doing, or with the help of finger. Now what patient is supposed to do? Patient is supposed to use only this little finger, a gloved little finger, which is well lubricated with a simple plain 2% log jelly. Okay? And slowly patient needs to put it inside the stoma and slowly lubricate and open it. Which means the patient trust it. Can we have the other mics closed, please? Ashish, can you please check that?
Yes, sir, done.
Thanks. So when the patient is doing, patient will use a gloved finger, which is well lubricated. Suppose this is a stoma, and patient will gently put it inside. He's not going to thrust it. He's gently going to maneuver it inside slowly, slowly, and just trying to lubricate it all around. So the jelly is all around. It serves a dual purpose. It not only opens the stomal opening of the mouth, it also helps to keep the stoma moist. So both things actually helps. Because sometimes what happens if this thing is prolonged, say the closure or the temporary blockage of the mouth, the stool that is remaining there will become more desiccated or getting more dry. So patient will have constipation. And when that particular fecal bolus comes out, it is going to scratch the mucosa, and patient will eventually have a bleeding. Something phenomena which is similar to hemorrhoids. Okay. So we don't want to have that particular problem with the patient. So we try to make the or keep the mouth patent. This is the whole purpose, by doing a self finger dilatation. So a well lubricated gloved finger, patient, and this patient may have to do maybe just a couple of days. Once it starts opening normally, then patient need not do it. It may be required in first few days. They said a procedure is done, and then patient supposes discharge, and patient is advised to have a look at the stoma properly with the help of mirror, and if no aperture is seen or no mouth, patient is supposed to do this self finger dilatation. Okay, so is this clear for everyone? This is actually a relatively simple concept, but it's a very useful and practical concept for the patient, because if it gets blocked, then patient will have a really tough problem. Inside fecal matter will become more and more hard, and it will be really difficult to bring it out. So patient needs to lubricate it well, nicely, with a gloved finger. Usually a little finger is there. And at least twice a day, morning and evening, patient needs to do the self finger dilatation. Once it is done and it starts opening properly, then there is no problem. Then eventually the fecal matter will pass very comfortably for the patient. Okay, now you can go next, where you were on the general examination.
Blood pressure 110 by 72 millimeters of mercury in right brachial artery in supine position. Pallor, edema, ictus, cyanosis, clubbing absent. No generalized lymphadenopathy seen. Local examination. examined with due consent under adequate illumination, exposure from nipples to knee in standing as well as supine position, inspection, stoma, exteriorized loop of bowel with two opening is visible in the left iliac fossa. It
now,
is attached with
stromal bag. Now, this inspection
bag.
You have done in which position?
In standing as well as supine position.
Okay, so first you finish the standing position inspection and then you can mention that I have now re-inspected a patient in supine position to reconfirm or to check whether the findings remain consistent or not. Fine?
Stoma.
So now tell in standing position.
Sir, are the findings different in standing as well as supine position?
They may differ, no? Why we are checking in standing position? Because the optimum stomal morphology will be visible when the patient is standing erect.
Right.
Suppose there is some protrusion or there is some parastomal herniation or some obvious discharge that is going to come. It will come out. Okay. But patient is supine. So whatever discharge, if at all it is coming, it will not be visible. It will be drawn inside. Stoma will be drawn inside with the help of gravity and nothing else will be seen because patient is relaxed completely in supine position. So even the parastomal herniation may not be appreciated that. So that's why it is important.
Okay. Stoma is exteriorized loop of bowel with two opening and two opening is visible in the left iliac fossa. It is attached with the stromal bag. The loop is raised approximately 2 cm above the skin and is held in place with a rubber tube and structured to the anterior abdominal wall. Mucosa is pink, red and healthy. No signs of inflammation or bleeding or discharge seen. Wall of stoma is normal. No evidence of prolapse or retraction. No discharge or inflammation seen at the site of anastomosis with the skin. No skin around the stomal opening is smooth, healthy and dry. No signs of inflammation seen. No evidence of sinuses, excoriation or maceration. No evidence of fecal smell, irregular scar or skin fold corrugations. Palpation. Okay. Inspectory findings confirm.
What else
no
is stoma?
Local rise of temperature.
Shatabdi, what else on inspection when patient is standing? One more thing.
There is
you need
no
to mention.
Prolapse or retraction.
Uh-huh. See, now there are two things. Either the prolapse will happen spontaneously or you have to make it evident. So how will you make it evident?
Okay.
You can ask patient to strain or cough. Just like you check for a cough impulse. Okay. So by this maneuver, what you will see, if at all, there is some temporary prolapse, one thing. And second thing you can pick up is a parastomal herniation.
Mm.
Okay? So these two entities can be seen or appreciated when you ask patient to do certain maneuvers like coughing or raising intra-abdominal pressure. So that is what you're supposed to mention on inspection. Now, as you're aware, patient is in standing position. Now, you have to re-examine or re-inspect the patient in supine position. How you will do that? You ask patient to just lie down and see any change in the size of a stoma. So if the stoma is decreasing in size or if the hernia, which was otherwise evident, is now not remaining evident, it is falling back or getting reduced spontaneously. And a discharge, if at all, it was present when standing, now disappearing. So these three points specifically you need to check. When patient is in standing position, and when patient in supine position, there is change. So you have to prove it dynamically without touching the patient that yes, my patient is having these changes. Rest. See, the diameter won't change. The other things will not change. Say, for example, mucosal pattern won't change. It will remain same, like pink and healthy, if at all. But these three points are likely to change when patient is standing against patient is supine, especially on inspection. Fine? So once you complete that, then only you move to the palpation.
Okay. So I mentioned about parastomal hernia and cough impulse in palpation. So I should mention this in inspection. Yes. I mentioned it in pulsation.
Okay. Yeah. See, it's same, na, like hernia case. On inspection also, we observe the expansile cough impulse. Same thing, we perceive it when you are palpating it. Correct? So same thing is true here. If you have mentioned in palpation, fantastic. But you have to also mention on inspection.
Okay.
Then?
So I'll move ahead to palpation.
Yes, please. Proceed.
Inspectory findings confirmed. No local rise in temperature. Tenderness is absent. Stoma. It is a loop stoma. Viability checked by tube test. Mucosa is dry. No evidence of bleeding or discharge seen. No evidence of parastomal hernia since cuff impulse is absent. No evidence of stenosis, stricture or impaction since stoma allows introduction of finger. No evidence of warmth, tenderness at the site of anastomosis with skin as well as on the surrounding skin.
Okay, now what is tube test?
Sir, in tube test, a tube test tube is put inside and a light is projected in. If by this we note the color of the mucosa, if it is pink, dusky, or if it is black.
Okay. Then proceed.
A stomal bag. The attached stomal bag is a two-piece disposable type of bag with flanks, space, opaque, properly fitted, and contains semi-solid stools. It is changed once every 3 days. Okay. Systemic examination. CVS, S1, S2 heard, no murmur. Respiratory system, normal shape and movement, resonant note heard all over. CNS, no abnormality detected, all reflexes normal. For abdomen, no abnormality detected, no scar, tenderness, distension of abdomen, dull note heard on percussion, PR examination normal. Diagnosis.
See, now the scar will be present, no? Or no?
Sir, other scars except for the stoma.
Other scar means which scar?
Any other scar. So I have to mention about the stoma here also.
No. What I'm saying, see, per abdomen, patient has undergone some surgery, correct?
Right.
What surgery was there? You mentioned in the history as well as in the...
Yes, sir.
What was the surgery?
He underwent a temporary loop diverting descending colostomy.
No. Major surgery, anything he has undergone?
Carcinoma rectum. He underwent...
So what was done for that? I think you mentioned about it, that's why I'm asking.
No, I did not mention.
No, you mentioned, is it the anterior resection?
Yes, sir, I think so. I'll just check.
You only mentioned, no?
Yes, sir, anterior resection. Right.
Right, no? First slide.
Right. Yes.
Don't forget what you're presenting.
Okay.
It's elective. See, you have written nicely, that's why I'm asking. Elective temporary loop. First slide. Yeah.
Elective temporary loop colostomy.
Anterior section. So the scar of anterior section is visible. Mention that.
Okay.
Fine. You don't mention. See, when you mention no scar, no, then it will alarm. So please mention that. Okay. Now, palpation
scar
over.
Scar of anterior resection is visible.
Is okay. In the midline. Okay.
In the tenderness.
Yeah.
Absent. Yeah. Distension of abdomen.
This patient of yours, Shashatabdi, how many days post-op approximately?
10 days.
10 days. Okay. Fine. Yes. Go on.
Dull note heard on percussion. PR examination normal.
Okay.
Diagnosis. Patient Kamal Chauhan, 60-year-old Hindu married male residing at Turbhe, laborer by occupation, underwent a temporary diverting loop descending colostomy in left iliac fossa to allow healing for distal anastomosis and is without any complication at present.